Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Mesa Arts Center. As a courtesy to others, please silence all cell phones and other electronic devices. At this time, please take a moment to look around you and find the exit nearest your seat. In the unlikely event of an emergency, please proceed to that exit in an orderly manner. From there, ushers will direct your departure from the building. Thank you. The performance will begin in just a few moments.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ella Browder, and I serve as Valley Christian High School's student body president. I am thrilled to welcome you to our 17th annual Christmas Extravaganza. This evening, you will hear from over 200 of our high school students whose prayer is that you are blessed as we proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. Before going any further, we need to recognize the groups that made this event possible. I want to give a huge thank you to our presenting sponsor, Compass Christian Church. I also want to thank our Platinum Corporate Sponsors, Strategic Income Group, Falco, Suzuki Law Offices, Arizona Community Church, and RCS Fund. Thank you again to all of our sponsors. Before we begin our show, I would love to open us up in prayer. Please bow your heads with me. God, thank you for gathering us tonight for such an incredible event. We are so excited to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. So much has gone into making this performance the best it can be, and that can only be done with your strength. I ask that you be with each performer and help them glorify you through their work. Allow for us to reflect on our Savior's birth and remember Christ's abundant love for us. Bless these performers while they worship you through expression and song. Glory be to you all throughout tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Without further ado, we present to you Christmas Extravaganza.
Thank you. We all have to go. creates a tradition in homes across America, beginning somewhere after Halloween and right before Christmas.
Families gather around their televisions with their popcorn and hot chocolate.
Grown men are reduced to tears.
Women declare, "That's the sweetest thing I've ever seen."
It's the Christmas movie.
Hollywood figured out decades ago that no matter what age you are,
or religion,
or tolerance for mush, everybody loves a Christmas movie.
Some Christmas movies have become film classics and have earned a place in the most beloved movies of all time. But what does a great movie start with?
Money!
Movie stars.
Studio executives who are so overblown with their self-importance that they can't see beyond the bottom line of what their earnings will be worldwide.
Okay, well, there's that. But more importantly, the thing a great blockbuster really needs, the thing that all great writers and directors are drawn to...
A story!
A story!
Great story is where it all begins!
Consider the story of a man who had it all.
Who thought he had it all.
Okay, well, actually, he had a little.
Oh, he had money. He had a lot of money.
Okay, but that was about all he had.
He had a spirit visit him.
He had an employee who had nothing.
Oh, the employee had everything.
But he had no money. He had the most important thing.
And there begins a classic telling.
The beloved story.
The cautionary tale.
A Christmas Carol.
This movie was really long. How are we gonna fit into 5 minutes?
I have faith in us. Ready? Once. Back in the olden days.
The days of yore.
The time of yesteryear.
Lived an old man. He was a very old and lonely man, and his name was...
Scrooge McDuck!
What?
Scrooge McDuck.
No, just Scrooge. Ebenezer Scrooge. You know, George C. Scott.
Oh, sorry, I grew up on the Mickey Mouse version.
Okay, where was I? Lonely old man? Yes, Ebenezer Scrooge.
No, Bob Cratchit, that's absurd. Why should I give you a whole day off?
Well, you see, sir, it's because tomorrow is Christmas.
Christmas? Humbug!
Come on, please.
Oh, all right. Take tomorrow off, but come in really early the next day.
Wait, really?
Well, we only have a few minutes for this story. Better get on with it, eh?
Oh, right. Yes, thank you, sir. God bless you, sir, and Merry Christmas!
So, Scrooge closes up shop and heads home. As he settles in for the night, he begins to hear noises in his house.
Things that go bump in the night.
What is... Who's there?
Hello?
Ah! Molly! My old business partner! How is it you're here? Unless you're a ghost.
I've come to give you a warning, Ebenezer. Tonight you'll be visited by three ghosts. The ghost of Christmas past, the ghost of Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmas future.
Why is this happening?
Because, Evie, you're a mean old man and nobody likes you. Also, I don't want you to end up like me, suffering for eternity.
But Molly, you were a great person, a business giant.
Maybe so, but my business should have been mankind.
No, no. It's a figment of my imagination, something I ate, that burrito I had from lunch.
Oh, I assure you it's real.
No. Get away from me, spirit! Get away!
So, the spirit disappears, and Scrooge, believing he has suffered a terrible hallucination from some suspicious food, falls asleep in his bed, only to be awakened later that night.
Scrooge! Scrooge!
What is it? Who's there?
Scrooge, it is I, the ghost of Christmas past!
No!
Yes.
No, if I can't see you, you're not there!
What are you, four? Open your eyes and let's get on with it!
What do you want with me, spirit?
Open your eyes.
Where are we?
We are in the past. In your past. This is your...
Yes, my boyhood home. I remember it well. That child...
Is you, Ebenezer. Abandoned. All alone.
Yes. His mother died in childbirth, so his father sent him off to this school.
Yes, we know, Ebenezer. Your childhood wasn't all that great.
But I grew up into a young man. I met a young woman. Her name was Belle.
Yes, we know. You fell in love with Belle, and she loved you back.
It was the happiest time of my life. I wanted to marry her. I needed to make my fortune.
And while you were running off making your fortune, Belle got bored. So much for love.
But I became rich!
Congratulations!
What happened to Belle?
She married someone else. She's blissfully happy. Unlike you. And so ends this past portion of this haunting. Now I must leave you.
And now it's my turn. I'm the ghost of Christmas present. Let's go see what everyone's doing right now.
Oh, Spirit, I'm quite tired. I think I'd like to take a nap.
No nap. On your feet. You can sleep when you're dead, which is soon enough.
What was that?
Nothing. Cecil, the ghost of Christmas future, will tell you all about it.
His name is Cecil.
We are at the home of your employee, Bob Cratchit, and this is his son, Tiny Tim.
God bless us, everyone.
Tim is very sick and not likely to live much longer.
Father, will there be any supper for Christmas?
Oh, why yes, Tim. The finest goose you've ever seen.
That's not much of a goose.
Curious, since you pay him so well.
Father, will there be any Christmas presents?
We have each other, and that's all the Christmas we need. I propose a toast to Mr. Scrooge.
To Mr. Scrooge? Now, miser! Wild!
God bless us, everyone.
Now, dearest, we mustn't speak ill of Mr. Scrooge. It is Christmas, after all. To Mr. Scrooge!
To Mr. Scrooge!
God bless
us. We get it, Tim.
Oh, Spirit, I can't watch anymore. That poor child.
But don't you see, Scrooge? You're all a part of this. This is your fault.
No. Want me no more, Spirit! Want me no more! Please. Please, no. Please, I don't want it anymore. Please. Please. Spirit of Christmas future. Please, I can take no more. What is it you want to show me? Please move on with it so I can end this nightmare. No. No, it can't be. No! I don't want to die. I don't want to die. I don't want to end up like Marley. I don't want to miss Christmas. I don't want to miss the season finale of The Voice! No. Wait. I'm awake!
Scrooge was so excited that his visits from the ghosts were over. He ran to the window and said,
"You there, boy! What day is it?"
"Why, it's Christmas Day, sir."
"Yes, indeed it is. Run to the store and buy the prize turkey in the window. And Merry Christmas!"
Ebenezer Scrooge bought the turkey in the window. He had it delivered to the Cratchits' house, and not only did he provide them with enough food for a feast, he also doubled Bob's salary and made sure Tiny Tim would live.
God bless us, everyone.
What's a gift to be given?
A second chance.
A chance to change, to make a difference.
Just like the new fallen snow that makes everything new and clean, our Heavenly Father grants us the chance to empty our lives of the bitterness and regret.
Redemption.
Grace.
Mercy.
Themes that are widely accepted over the Christmas season, whether you're a church-going believer or not. People are searching for a second chance.
A do-over.
I wish I'd been better with my money.
I wish I hadn't said that to my mom.
I wish my relationships weren't struggling.
I wish I could go back home.
But thankfully, we serve a God who gives second chances.
We serve a God who specializes in grace.
Consider the story of a man.
A man who had everything.
He had a family who loved him.
He had a nice house.
He had a nice job.
He was respected in the town.
He made it possible through his building and loan business for people to have a home.
A roof over their heads.
Because George loved his community.
He had a spirit visit him.
No, not a spirit. An angel.
He had a wonderful life.
I'm telling you, Mr. Potter, you won't get the best of me.
Now, George, I'm not trying to get the best of anybody. Clearly, your building and loans can't pay up on the money you owe people. I'm here to help. Come work for me, everything will be all right. I can get you the money you need to keep out of jail.
I'll never work for you, Potter. You're just a mean old man who wants to own this town.
George Bailey was a type of man that everyone loved. He was the town's hero. He saved his brother from an icy death when they were just boys.
He stayed home with his parents until his brother could return home from the war, giving up his dreams to travel.
He kept the town together and united during a stock market crash. He was the kind of man who seemed to have it all together.
But George found him in a situation where all hope seemed lost.
In fact, everything seemed lost.
crazy Uncle Billy lost a stack of money that was supposed to keep things afloat.
But even the best of men have their breaking point and need to be reminded of the most important things in life.
Confound it! Why can't anything go right?
George! George, what's the matter?
Who's playing the piano? Can't she learn a different song?
But Daddy, I'm practicing for the Christmas party.
Humbug, I say!
What was that, dear?
Oh, sorry. I was listening to another Christmas story earlier, and that word, it got stuck in my head. Now, where was I? Oh, yes. Nothing ever goes right for me. I'm gonna run out in the snow, be miserable, and think about how horrible my life is.
But George!
So, George wandered around in the snow and darkness,
went into a bar and got in a fight,
crashed his car into a tree,
and came up on a bridge, and a thought.
A thought.
A thought crossed his mind.
I could end it all right here! It could all be over! I won't have to feel regret or disappointment anymore. I've lost everything. My family hates me. I've lost all our money. Mr. Potter's gonna have me thrown in jail just because I can't pay on a loan? It's all over. So I might as well just end it.
And just as George contemplated ending it all, there was a big splash in the icy water below. You know, there are days when we feel like there's nothing left to do but give up.
Like, we just shouldn't have gotten out of bed that day.
Maybe the world is better off without us.
Enter Clarence, the angel. Now, George,
being the honorable man that he is,
jumped in to save Clarence, who had jumped into the icy water below.
Well, why'd you go ahead and do a thing like that for?
I did it to save you.
Save me? You jumped in first.
Well, you were gonna jump, so I jumped first, and that helped you change your mind.
Oh, I wish I'd never been born.
Wow, you're right to it, don't you?
Time crunch.
Oh, George Bailey, since you are so miserable and believe the world would be better off without you, I hereby declare you never been born.
Now you're crazy. Okay, never been born? Who do you think you are? An angel? Wait a minute. This isn't Martini's bar. And Mr. Gower? What happened to you?
Oh, he could put some poison in a kid's prescription back when he was a pharmacist and went to jail for like 20 years.
Wait. What?
It's because you weren't there to stop him, George. Remember? You've never been born.
Oh, you're talking crazy. Bedford Falls has gone crazy.
What? Bedford Falls? No, this is Pottersville.
No way.
Way.
It finally started to sink in with George that Clarence really was his guardian angel and that he had made it so George had never been born. George found himself in a cemetery and came up on a name with a familiar name on it.
Wait. This is Harry Bailey. That's my brother. Harry didn't die. He went on to save a whole transport of troopers during the war.
No, all those men died, George. Harry was never there to save him because you were never there to save him when he fell in the lake all those years ago.
Clarence, where's Mary? Where's my wife?
Oh, you really don't want to see her.
This is where it gets really dramatic, and this is the part of the movie where I cry every time.
Me too.
You have to tell me.
George found Mary closing at the library. She was an old maid.
Hey!
Well, that's what the story says. She was an old maid.
Did you have to say it again?
You made me lose my place.
Hmm.
Old maid. George is shocked when he sees her and tries to convince her that she is his wife.
Mary! Mary, don't you know me?
Ah!
Why are you screaming?
Ah!
Hey, what's going on here? You get out of here, man we've never seen before who for all intents and purposes might as well have never been born.
George ran back to the bridge to reconsider his original thought of ending it all. After all, he'd lost everything he cared about.
His family.
That was about it. He loved and cared for his family.
The town and all the people in it, they were all his family.
People are what mattered most to George.
Not money or possessions.
He cared about making a difference in people's lives.
God, please, just let me have my life back. I want to live, please.
George, you better come with me. I've been looking all over town for you.
Wait, you know me. You know my name.
Of course I do, George.
Merry Christmas.
George ran back to his wife and children, not caring any more that he would probably be thrown in jail because Mr. Potter wanted George arrested.
Merry Christmas, Bedford Falls. Merry Christmas, Movie House. Merry Christmas, Emporium. Merry Christmas, you old building and loan.
George ran all the way home to find the police there waiting for him. But George didn't care.
He didn't care about going to jail?
Because he had his family back. But not only that, there was a bonus. People from all over town were flooding their house to show their love and support for George.
And George and Mary Bailey lived happily ever after.
George learned that Christmas wasn't about the things you can accumulate. It's not about having the biggest house or the most money.
It's about the lives you touch and the people that you surround yourself with.
People are what mattered most to George.
I mean, that's great for the Baileys, but what about me? Where's my happily ever after?
Yeah, I've been waiting around for so long and I'm still stuck in a rut. Nothing seems to go right. Maybe I should just jump in an icy river and see if someone will bail me out.
It's been 3 months, and I still can't find a job. How am I supposed to give Christmas presents this year?
It just doesn't seem to matter how good or faithful I am. I can't catch a break. I go to church, I serve my community, I'm faithful with my tithe.
Yeah, where's my Clarence?
Yeah, why can't things ever go right for me like George?
Why is it that at Christmas time, we feel so much more inept?
For once, I'd love to give my family the Christmas they deserve, but I just can't seem to keep my head above water.
Christmas isn't about giving, it's about receiving.
You're right, it's about giving. Wait, that's not what you said? You said it was about receiving?
Yeah, what's up with that? Christmas isn't about what you get, it's what you give.
No, that's where you're wrong.
How can she be wrong?
Consider the story of a boy, a round-headed kid who had an obsession with kicking footballs.
Oh, you mean Charlie.
Don't say his name.
Yeah, we can't say his name or the title because of copyright.
What's so wrong with saying the name Charlie?
Good. Just keep her there for a second.
I'd really like to know where you're going with this.
Wah, 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 wah.
Consider the story of a boy.
A boy who loved his dog.
He wanted to be happy at Christmas, but just couldn't seem to get in the spirit. So particular girl, who masqueraded as a therapist and was known to pull footballs out from under would-be kickers, put him in charge of the Christmas pageant to see if that might lift his spirits.
See, but that's where everything went wrong. The round-headed kid couldn't get everyone to focus on the pageant.
The kid playing the piano wouldn't stop playing the piano.
Kids wouldn't stop dancing.
It was a big ol' mess.
After rescuing a tiny Christmas tree to put in the Christmas pageant to get the ball rolling and being made fun of by everyone else because of said Christmas tree, our favorite blockhead gave up and realized he would never know the true meaning of Christmas.
But then, a wise kid with a blanket...
All smart and cool people have blankets.
Just saying.
A wise kid with a blanket reminded everyone what Christmas was all about.
Now, suddenly, there was angels keeping guard over their flock at night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around them, and they were absolutely terrified. And the glory of the Lord shone all around them. And the angel of the Lord said to them, "Do not be afraid. Listen carefully, for I proclaim to you the good news that will bring everyone joy. Today, your Savior is born in the town of David. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a vast heavenly army appeared, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among people with whom he is pleased."
Christmas is about receiving.
For in this way, God loved the world.
He gave his one and only Son,
so that anyone who believes in him will have eternal life and not perish.
Christmas is about receiving the gift God has given us, eternal life through Jesus.
Maybe your life isn't Hollywood. No one's is. But I contend that God has outdone anything that Frank Capra or Steven Spielberg has ever put on the silver screen. His plan is so much bigger for your life than Hollywood could ever dream of. His plan, his story,
begins with a baby.
A man.
A woman.
Chosen by God to deliver a very special gift to all mankind.
And talk about special effects. I mean, a giant bright star that led everyone to the baby?
Right! And then that one time when he was like all old and he was all like, I'm walking on water, y'all! And then he starts going out of it and healing people and casting out demons and he's all like, demon, come out! And then that one time when there was the hungry people and he got the fish and the bread.
Yes, Jesus did all that. But before he grew up, he was born to a simple carpenter.
Oh, yeah! And then he grew up and put all the Pharisees in their place, and he says, if you're without sin, cast the first stone. Do you remember that? That was awesome!
Yes, he did that too, but...
Oh, and then he was out in the desert, and the devil goes, hey, if you're the Son of God, you could totally take over everything. And Jesus goes, I so could, but I'm not gonna, because that's not the plan, loser.
The point is...
Then there was that one time where he was out in the desert and he saw the robot and the robot had the message from the princess and she's all like, you're my only hope! And then he was all got in his spaceship and he started blowing up... What do they call them? Planets! Started blowing up planets and he's all like, pew, 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 pew! And then he was on the bridge with the big demon and the staff and he's all like, you should not pass! And he's all like, no!
The point
and
is...
And then that one time when the elf got his bow and arrow.
All right.
Sorry.
The point is that God, in his infinite wisdom, has a plan.
A screenplay?
Okay. A screenplay for your life. God is the master storyteller and has written the story of your life. We all like to think that in our story, we're the disheartened bank manager that saves the day and wins the hearts of his friends and family, or the dramatically rich miser that has a classic change of heart. And yes, even the hero who saves the princess.
But what you'll most likely find is that your story is a lot like the one that God tells about himself.
A simple child from a simple birth, with humble beginnings from a backwoods town, just eking out enough life until it was time.
Time to help the helpless.
Time to heal the sick.
Time to feed the hungry.
Time to be the light.
Time to share his story.
Jesus Christ is Lord. And as you continue to celebrate the greatest story ever told this Christmas season, remember that your story,
the one God has crafted just for you,
isn't finished. For the one who began a good work in you will perfect it till the day of Christ Jesus.
God bless us,
everyone!
Thank you.
Now, therefore, in the same country, shepherds living out the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And the angel of the Lord appeared before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord."
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
He will save people from their sins, from the penalty of sin, from the power of sin, and one day, he will save us from the presence of sin.
But just how does he save us from the power of sin and its dominion over our lives?
Does he counter the destructive effects of sin in our lives?
He saves us by being Lord of our lives.
Lord. The Greek word is kurios, master. The word has its roots in the Old Testament name, Yahweh, Jehovah, the self-existent becoming one.
Let all those who have ears to hear, hear what the Spirit of the Lord would say.
I am Yahweh, the self-existent one, the becoming one, the great I am.
I have set my foot on the machinery of providence and history. What can I not do for you?
The name of the Lord is a strong fortress. The godly run to him and are safe.
I am Christ the Lord. There is no other. Call on me while I am near.
God, forgive me. I am so ashamed. My anger, my pride, the words of my mouth.
Lord, help me. You say forgive. I cannot. I am filled with hate and bitterness. It's tearing me up. It's eating me alive.
I am so humiliated and so angry. People are supposed to love each other. Why am I feeling this way? Again, I am in bondage to other people's ignorant words, to the guilt, the shame.
God, I am shaking. What if these results come back positive? How long will I have to live? How will my family pay for these hospital bills? What will happen to my family? Why me?
Children of God, draw near and hear what the Spirit says. I am Jehovah Sidkenu, the Lord your righteousness. Humble yourself, confess, repent, restore, and believe, and I will forgive your sin. I will cleanse your unrighteousness. I will give you a clean heart. Sin will not have dominion over you.
I am Jehovah Shammah, the Lord who is there. I enter your pain.
I am Christ the Lord. There is no other. Call on me while I am near. I came to save my people from their sins, from their hurts, from their bondage.
Lord, my heart is shattered. I am filled with grief. The fight was bad. I was so horrible. Will he leave me? God, it hurts. I'm so lonely. I'm so afraid. If he goes, who will have me? Lord, why?
I am afraid. What if there is no cure? How sick will these treatments make me? Will I always be in pain? Why me?
Lord, why did they treat me that way? I feel so helpless. I feel so ugly, so worthless. Why now?
Will things ever change? He's an innocent child. He has a good heart. Why does my brother have to endure such hate? Why does my brother have to endure such indignity? Why does he have to walk in fear as if he is an inferior being? I thought we had come so far. Why doesn't anybody care?
Child of God, draw near and hear the word of the Lord. I am El Shaddai, Almighty God. I have not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind.
I am Jehovah Shammah, the God who is there. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I enter your pain.
I am Jehovah Shalom, God your peace. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives.
I am Jehovah Jireh, God your provider. I will provide for you through my riches in Christ Jesus.
I am a God of mercy and grace. You will find that my grace is sufficient for you.
I have come. come that in me you'll have life abundantly.
I've come to set the captives free.
I am God. There is no other.
Lord, why did they treat me that way? I feel so betrayed. I want them to hurt as much as I do. Why can't I control my anger, my mouth? No wonder they hate me. Why do they keep using those hateful names? Why do they hate me?
Lord, I'm so fearful, so sad, all the time sad.
It's so dark and bottomless, like an abyss.
There is no hope.
No.
People of God, draw near and hear what the Spirit says.
I am Elroy, the God who sees, and I see you. I see every post, every comment, every shove, every touch.
I am Kohen Gadol, the High Priest who feels your worthlessness, but you have great value to me. Behold my nail-scarred hands.
I am Jehovah Rohi, God your shepherd. I will lead you beside still waters. My rod and my staff will comfort you.
I am Jehovah Jireh, God your provider. I will provide for you through my riches in Christ Jesus.
I am Jehovah Shammah, the God who is there. I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you.
I am a God of mercy and grace. My grace will be sufficient for you.
I am the Lord. There is no other.
I have set my foot on the machinery of providence and history. What can I not do for you?
If I have your eternity in my hands, can I also not take care of your now?
Draw near to me, and I will draw near to you.
I am Christ the Lord. There is no other. I have come to save you people from your sins. I offer you myself, the great I am, the self-existent one, El Shaddai, the Almighty God. If I be for you, who can stand against?
But the world presses in on me.
I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear.
When will you come to me? Why is heaven locked in silence?
My precious child.
I have sent to you many caretakers of the soul. Pastors, teachers, brothers, sisters, mothers, and fathers. Those with the gift of mercy, the gifts of compassion, and the gifts of wisdom and discernment. But you neglect assembling with them.
Sunday is an option for you. There is no day of rest and worship. My house is not your home.
And in your home, you neglect to wait on me, to sit in solitude with a quiet heart.
So yes, you are pressed for time. The cares and concerns of this life overwhelm you.
You cry out, but you do not linger to hear my voice.
You cry out, and then try to solve your issues in your own wisdom.
In your own power.
In your own strength.
To you, I am Jesus, a friend, a savior. But not Jesus Christ the Lord. You know of me, but you do not know me.
And you will never trust someone you do not know.
And will not know someone you will not spend time with. Is it any wonder you are undone?
Have you forgotten?
Unto you, born this day in the city of David, is Christ, the Savior.
I am anointed to preach the gospel to the poor. I have come to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind.
I have come to set at liberty those who are oppressed.
You shall call him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Are you listening with ears that open to your heart?
Let us begin again.
Come. There's only one thing that's needful, only one thing worth being concerned about. And when you discover it, it will not be taken from you.
Sit at my feet. Pour out your troubles. Linger in my presence.
Cast your cares upon me, for you are my personal concern.
Allow me to pour out my life into you through my word, my spirit, and come, worship me again in spirit and in truth.
Can anything ever separate you from my love? Does it mean I no longer love you if you have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger, or even threatened with death? No.
No.
No. Nothing could ever separate you from my love.
For I am
Jehovah Yahweh, the self-existent one.
Jehovah Jireh, the Lord my provider.
Jehovah Nissi, the Lord my banner.
Jehovah Rapha, the Lord my healer.
Jehovah Rohi, the Lord my shepherd.
Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts.
Jehovah Shalom, the Lord my peace.
Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there.
Jehovah
my righteousness, nothing can ever separate me from his love. Nothing, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither my fears for today, nor my worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate me from your love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate me from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus, my Lord.
Now there were in the same country shepherds, living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord."
Did you know that your baby boy Sacred.